There are a lot of things to know about the Godot engine. So here are 12 more things a Godot developer should know. Help us by commenting your Godot tricks. Number 1. Emit particles in shapes. Great news! Particle systems can emit in any shape you can imagine. So here's how it works by using an emission mask. Add a particle system to your scene and design it as usual. Draw a mask and import it as a PNG. Only the pixels that are fully visible will spawn particles. To add an emission mask, click on the Particles button and select Load Emission Mask. You can either let particles emit from the whole solid area or only along the outer border.
Number 2. Dialogic is a powerful dialogue system. It was made by Emilio Capola and you can get it at GitHub. It's under active development and the latest release came out just a week ago. It works fully within the engine and has this great editor for different dialogue paths. You can add characters, portraits, script out interactions and customize the style. To find out more, check out Emilio's channel.
Number 3. Callbacks with inheritance. There are a number of different pre-built callbacks that every node receives at different points in its lifetime. The most important ones are underscore, ready, process and physics process, but there are many more. When you have a class that inherits from another class, both of them can implement that callback and both will be called. You basically cannot prevent that. I think this is a bit strange and so seem to think a lot of people. This is why this behavior might change in Godot 4. The order of calls differs. For enter tree and ready, the superclass is called first. For process and exit tree, the subclass is called first. When you have any other function that is not pre-built, the superclass function is not called automatically. Instead, you can call them by putting a dot in front of that call. This is helpful when you want to add behavior to a callback but delegate the rest.
Number 4. Particle systems can have shaders. There are different kinds of shaders in Godot. Particle shaders calculate how a particle moves, and fragment shaders how an object looks. But there is no reason why you could not apply a fragment shader to a particle system. This is a really powerful tool to animate your particles. You can even make the particle animation depend on the particle's color or lifetime with a little trick. We made a cool crosslash effect with this and these elemental effects. You can find out how it is done in these videos.
Number 5. You can make collision shapes visible in the game. You can make collision shapes visible for debugging purposes. This can really save some time debugging collision issues. But be aware, they still cannot be seen when set to be invisible. Collision points and lines are also drawn. You can even configure the colors in the project settings. The same is possible for navigation shapes.
Number 6. The ways to access a node. In almost every script, you need to access nodes of the scene tree. As soon as the node is added to the tree, you can get it through the getNode function, like this. You can both use relative paths and absolute paths. However, if the node you request does not exist, the method will result in an error. If you expect that case and want to handle it, you can use getNodeOrNull. So if the node is not found, you get null. An abbreviated notation for getNode is the dollar operator. With this, you only need to use quotation marks if the path has spaces in it. If you want to access a node whose path you don't exactly know, you can use findNode, which searches the tree for a node with a name that matches the mask. But be aware, this method can be slow.
Number 7. Curves can help you polish your game and do maths. Curves are so useful. Really one of our favorite tools. We mostly use them for polish, because they are a very visual way of designing and can be easily tweaked. And as we all know, faster iteration times means more iterations, means better polish. You can add a curve by creating a new resource. Then you can preload it in a script. The curve always is defined from 0 to 1. If you want larger values, you can just transform them to fit the space. We use curves to describe the size of a damage number in relation to the damage, the acceleration of the player movement, the speed of a projectile on its path. They are also great for experience curves and things like that. It is often simply a better solution than fiddling around with a very complex formula. Also, there are curve textures, which can be passed to a shader. We made a particle shader to make particles follow a trajectory. And this black hole here is very easily done by describing the deformation with a curve. We will link the tutorial for that once we made it.
Number 8. Collision layer and mask changes are not passed to instances sometimes. Still debugging area or body collisions, if you checked that the collision shapes are in the right positions, maybe the layers or masks causing the problem. Two objects collide when one of the objects has a mask that overlaps with the other object's collision layers. You can set the mask and layer in the node's properties. However, when you inherit from the scene, then instantiate it into another scene, and later change the collision layer or mask in the base scene, it does not change in the instance, although it did change in the inherited scene. This is something to be aware of, so you don't search for that for hours.
Number 9. How to affect process priority. Generally, things get processed flat down the tree. This means that the process and physics process function get called in the same order as the nodes are drawn, from top to bottom. However, there are situations when you want to have better control over the order of these methods. You can enforce the order of execution by setting the process priority of one of the nodes. The nodes with lower process priority values are executed first.
Number 10. Keybinds are useful. Godot offers a massive amount of project settings. In the Input Map tab, you can define input actions for your project, such as walking in four directions, UI navigation, or a text. You can assign a key, a mouse button, a controller button, or analog stick direction to the action. Now, when you receive an input event, you can check the defined actions. This allows you to change the input mapping at a central location without looking up the locations where you process the events in your scripts. Also, you can easily give players the option to change the input. To do that, you have to erase the previously set event and set it to a new input by calling the input map single.
Number 11. You can turn off editor features you don't use. It is possible to disable nodes and tabs that you simply do not intend to use. To do that, open the editor tab and select Manage Editor Features. Our own project is purely 2D, so we can just remove everything 3D. This removes a lot of clutter. It can also be very helpful when teaching or working in a team. You can even make profiles for when you have various projects.
Number 12. Hiding the console window. Another adaptation you can make to Godot's interface is to disable the console window that automatically opens with Godot. Thank you, Bitbirdie, for giving us this tip. Check out her content, she makes great videos. While there are times when the console's outputs contain valuable debug information, most of the things it displays are also shown in the output tab in the engine. And if you close the window by accident, you close the engine. To hide it, go to Editor, Editor Settings, Interface, Hide Console Window.
And just like that, the informative part of this video is over. But we will still keep on talking. Just less informative. We make videos every week. And if you like this one, you will probably like the other ones as well. We made a video about 10 and 11 things in the past. And who would have thought? It slowly gets out of hand. If you are interested in seeing how far we can push it, subscribe to our channel. Currently, we work on our game Firsifas Fungeon, which is our first serious attempt at game dev. It is chaotic and bouncy, please go check it out. And it turns out some people want to talk to us. You can do that on Twitter and on our Discord. Also, thank you guys so much for all the nice comments under our videos. We are so impressed how kind people on the internet are to us. The Godot community really is something special. However, there's one thing that keeps coming up. It is our German accent. And I think we owe you an answer. The reason why you hear a German accent is because we both are from Germany and we speak with a German accent. And now that this is out, we can finally eat a Käsebockwurst on camera without feeling weird about it. It is really freeing. So we hope you liked this video. And now go on and have a nice rest of your day.